Josh Rubenstein, Media Director for Kaiser Permanente Southern California, and this is another KP Candid Conversation. Honest conversations with our physicians and staff about health and well-being, and today's topic, something that is very near and dear to me, and that is colorectal cancer. I'm a five-year survivor of colorectal cancer. And today we are talking to a doctor of internal medicine in San Diego, Dr. Candace Sprott, about diagnosing, understanding this disease. Startling statistics, one in 23 men and one in 26 women will be diagnosed with colorectal cancer this year. Dr. Candace Sprott, internal medicine in San Diego. And we are talking about colorectal cancer, colon cancer, rectal cancer. So I want to start sort of general and then kind of hone down on some specific points. And we were talking before this started that this is something that I'm pretty passionate about because I had I'm a colorectal cancer survivor. I was relatively young. You know, back when it was 50 years old that you should go get your colonoscopy. And so it was shocking to me and my family. And I know that we're seeing the numbers, the ages drop down. Is that something that is pretty dramatic, that we're seeing those lower and lower ages of people who are getting it?
Absolutely, Josh. And definitely big congratulations to you, for, I'm sure, being your own best advocate and getting through this situation that's life altering and very scary. So glad to have you still here and advocating for this. So excellent. Yeah, what we're seeing is that, the incidence of death has really dropped from the 1970s to 2020, but the incidence in folks under 50 is rising. You know, one in 10 folks will develop colorectal cancer under 50, and it's very scary. I'm sure that many people remember Chadwick Boseman's death, right, which was pretty shocking, and he was a wonderful pillar to the kind of the Black community. And so it really started a conversation about how could this happen? He's so young. So as tragic as it was, I think it pushed people to start having that conversation and really looking at their own health. Have they gotten screened appropriately, or have their family members?
Yeah, young and seemingly healthy guy, right? A movie star, and right. this good looking movie star. He's not someone who, was obese or, looked like he was living this unhealthy lifestyle. Right. And so there's that misnomer, right? That, it only happens to someone like that.
Right. Right. I mean, he was the pillar of health. I mean, he's Black Panther, right? So clearly, he's just doing all the things. I think he was still filming while he was, undergoing chemo and whatnot. It really is concerning. And we don't yet understand exactly everything that goes into why this is happening. And certainly, I think some of the things we can think about, you mentioned some risk factors already, some that are modifiable and some that aren't. And I think really looking at those modifiable risk factors is important, which can be your diet, your level of activity, smoking, alcohol. Mm-hmm. Family history, of course, is not modifiable. But then really asking your physician, having that conversation, am I at risk? Am I doing my screening? Where are we with this? So really speaking up about it.
So just for definition, we say mm-hmm. colorectal cancer, colon cancer, and rectal cancer, right? And it's based on where the cancer occurs, right, in the intestine? Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, yes. So the colon is, the large intestine that really, its main function is to kind of create, if you will, stool and form stools so it can excrete waste. And when we talk about the colon, it's kind of a U-shape. So we think about kind of left-sided versus right-sided colon cancers. And then the rectum is that portion that's at the, end of the left side of the colon that extends to the outside. And so the differentiation is based on some of the cells, the cell types there. And there are different risk factors for each, but we kind of lump them all together as colorectal.
And is there one particular area that's more dangerous than another wherever it occurs? Or is it, are my problems equally bad everywhere?
I think it's certainly bad everywhere. And where we're looking at more of the rectal cancers, we look at those as being more risky from a viral standpoint even. There are some viruses that we know that transform those cells, HPV being one of them. But looking in this, the colon area, left-sided versus right-sided, with the left side, you would kind of, no one's hoping for cancer, but the symptoms that you may have may be more classic. So if you have a tumor that's growing in the colon on the left side, it may obstruct the stool getting out. So you may have narrower stools. You may have difficulty getting your stools out. So new or unexplained constipation, abdominal pain, rectal bleeding, even microscopic, versus the right side that may be more silent. And interesting, I'm also very passionate about this, not just as a physician, but my father is a survivor of colorectal cancer that was right-sided. And it presented as appendicitis. And then when they actually went and looked, it was cancer. So again, you know, this hits home to me too. And I'm so passionate about getting the word out there because he's a survivor. He's about 6 years out as well. And
Good.
I mean,
That's good
it's
to
wild.
Hear. That's good to hear. And so you brought up something interesting there, and we'll talk about demographics and how that plays into this. But there is one thing that transcends demographics, and that is it's embarrassing to talk about it when you get some of those symptoms. So people often either slough it off as something else, insignificant, or don't want to talk about it, don't want to tell their doctor about it. And do you find that frustrating when this is a cancer that is curable, right? This is a curable cancer.
Absolutely. You know, I think it is frustrating, but I also understand it because when you come to the doctor's office, there's a lot of preconceived notions. And if you've had difficult experiences before with feeling not heard or not having empathy shown for your situation, then it can be hard to open up. So I always tell my patients, like, look, behind this white coat, which is on my chair, you know, I'm a person. You'll see me at the grocery store. I'll be out at Costco. So let's just talk. And I take care of your entire body. This is not embarrassing to me. And I want to know about what you're experiencing. And so I think part of it is if you're, as a patient, you're feeling like you're not being heard by your physician, that could be a signal that it may not be a good fit. And you may have to find somebody who you have a better communication style with. So that way you can open up about those things. And sometimes it could be gender specific, but I have a lot of guys who have no problems telling me about what's going on. None whatsoever.
Well, and I'm glad you mentioned that as well. We've seen it. First of all, I'm going to ask the question, is it true that we see worse outcomes for communities of color, for African-Americans, Hispanics?
Yes, absolutely. And so, I just had a chance to look up some statistics before we got on the call today, and it was also still a bit shocking for me because I don't think I'd process these numbers, you know, that African-American communities are 20% more likely to get a diagnosis of colon cancer, but 40% more likely to die from it. And that's pretty profound. As you said, this is a curable cancer when found early.
So would you, and I know that, you know, you probably have to pore over the data, but would it be access and trust that contribute to that number?
I think so. You know, we can't have this conversation without bringing up some hard topics. And, you know, there truly has been a resurgence, but a recognition that the medical community, the system, has tenets of systematic racism baked within it, unfortunately. We've seen that with equations. Recently, we talked about changing the equations for kidney function because they had race-based coefficients. And the grassroots kind of organization from medical students started questioning, why is this the thing? You know, why are we saying that a social construct, which is race, truly has impact on anatomy and physiology? So because of that, and the probably inherent mistrust that communities of color have with the system brings up, right, as you were saying, don't want to bring it up, don't feel like they'll be heard. And because of this, there may also be a community, I'm not going to say community, but maybe more of a culture of not talking about it. You know, I can tell you certainly in my family, my grandparents, I don't know anything about their history. This wasn't something we talked about. So that coupled together with potentially under insurance, social determinants of health that may make it more difficult to get and secure regular visits. All those lead to, you know, a diagnosis that is potentially more aggressive or later stage that would lead to death.
It's also probably why it's so important that we have doctors like you, so that if I'm a person of color, I'm coming in and I'm seeing someone who looks like me, who understands where I've been, what I've been through, right?
I think you're absolutely right. You know, the research on diversity, equity, inclusion really does show that outcomes tend to be better when you have a race or culture concordant physician. And I can tell you, on the other side of the white coat, when I'm a patient, when I walk into a room and, you know, my OB-GYN doctor was a Black female, there was just an immediate sense of relief that I had to really have someone who I didn't have to explain a lot of different things to. I knew that she was going to get me, or at least I assumed, and she did. And I also felt very much like my health was in good hands because she knew how dangerous this could be for me as a Black woman, just having a child, you know. So I think so. That doesn't mean that the work stops here, right? I think that even when I care for my Hispanic patients, my Asian American patients, my patients of all different races, I have to do the work to really learn about how to best address them culturally and where they're coming from. And my colleagues do too. But yeah, there's something to be said about, you know, having someone who just kind of gets you taking care of you.
So how can we do better? How do we do better just as an organization? Because I know KP is committed to this. You know, in our med school, in the way in which we hire doctors, in the way in which we talk about it. How do we do better?
That's a big question. And I think that, you know, there's a lot of ways that KP and our medical group can improve the pipeline. You know, I think looking at improving the number of physicians of color is important. Right now, I think it's still at 2%, you know, the number of Black physicians there are in the country, 2%. So, and I say this a lot, I'm in the North County of San Diego, and there's five Kaiser office buildings, and I think I'm the only Black physician. I think someone just retired, but so that's a big population to serve with just me. So when I think about pipeline, we got to get more folks interested and supported in medicine. And I know that Kaiser has a program called Hippocrates Circle, where our physicians of color will go out to the community and talk about their jobs and try to get that interest early on. So that's a great program. We need to probably bolster that. We have a med school in Pasadena, which I think as long as we are looking at admissions, right, are we looking at admissions from different lenses to increase that population of color? And that may be looking at different statistics as opposed to standardized test scores. And then once you're in practice, what supports do we have? Are there places where physicians of color can feel supported either culturally or with leadership opportunities or whatever their passion is? Are they really cared for in a way that feels authentic? And I think that those are all ways to kind of do better, as you said. But it's going to take some time. You know, it takes a long time to train a physician. I can tell you.
It does. And unfortunately, when we see instances of this particular disease going up and up and up, you know, you know, we get behind. What kind of things now, just for everybody, can we do to slow this down or to, you know, do better at getting help when it comes to colorectal cancer?
Yeah, I think prevention is key, right? Just like most of the forms of colorectal cancer are sporadic. So there are some genetic syndromes, and we're not going to talk about those. But really, those risk factors that I touched on a little bit earlier, you know, make sure that when you're seeing your physician regularly, to make sure that you are getting good advice about the nutrition you're doing, the exercise you are doing, the lifestyle habits that lead to that. And talk to your family members. You know, is there something in the family that, you know, did your aunt and uncle have colon cancer or colorectal cancer? Did your grandma, like, those things matter for each individual. So get some more information about that. And then I think if you really want to have that conversation with your doc, talk about the different types of screening. A lot of folks balk at like a colonoscopy because they're like, it's kind of scary sounding, and you know, you get some light anesthesia. There are other options that are all very good that I think folks can engage with to get that screening done. And it may be as simple as doing a stool smear once a year, all the way to colonoscopy every 10 years. But talk to your doctor about what is right for you. And for me, I think the best test is the one that we do, the one that gets done.
What do you love about being a physician?
You know, I am very relational oriented. I love the relationships I develop with my patients, and being able to support them through the ups and downs, and knowing that I've got their back, that is what gets me coming to the office every day. And I also do pediatrics, so I get to see little kids here and there. So it's fun. It really is.
Well, our northern San Diego county is very lucky to have you. So I appreciate that. I appreciate the time you spent with us. And, you know, from one cancer survivor to your dad, you know, wishing him nothing but many years of health.
Thank you, Josh. And same to you. I really appreciate you having this conversation, too. It's been great.
Thank you.